Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to yet another fantastic lecture for today. However, ladies and gentlemen, if this is the first time you are being with us, consider subscribing. Ladies and gentlemen, today I'm going to take you through a very important module called Gender Relations. And today I'll give you a thorough introduction to the concept of gender and the concepts that are related to it. Just as a topical outline, I'll be taking you through the definition of gender, different forms of gender, and the CEDAW Convention that was instituted by the United Nations. Subsequently, we'll be looking at the Resolution 1325, Resolution 2000, and the Resolution 1320 as time progresses. However, ladies and gentlemen, for today, I will just be looking at an introduction to the concept of gender and development and in relation to our context in CRU. However, when you talk about gender, what comes in your mind? Most people have misunderstood the concept of gender. Some has always said it always means men and women. Others misunderstand gender to mean just sexes, etc. Well, today we are going to look at an academic perspective to understanding the concept of gender and development. When we talk about gender, we say gender is a range of characteristics pertaining to and differentiating between masculinity and femininity. Depending on the context, these characteristics may be biological, sex, that is the state of being male, female, or intersex variation. Sex-based social structures. You see, when you talk about gender, most people refer to it as the difference between males and females. Well, there can be difference between gender and sex. Well, most people refer to sexes to be categorized into two, which are males and females. But out of these sexes, we now have different categories of genders, which we are going to discuss as we progress. Gender equity requires equal enjoyment that men and women of socially valued goods, opportunities, resources, and rewards. Gender equity does not mean that women and men become the same, but that their opportunities and life chances are equal. You know, it has always been the case that women, gender equality is very important. When we talk about gender equality, we are not talking about men and women being the same. No, that is a misconception. Because they cannot be the same. They have different genders already. Now, we are talking about them being exposed to the same opportunities, equalities, and their privileges, both socially, economically, politically, etc. They need to be exposed to those various opportunities, and that is what you're talking about here. What is our, why are we offering this movement in the first place? We are offering gender because we believe that for far too long, people have been misunderstanding the concept of gender, and we need to set the record straight. We also need to understand the different forms of gender. We also need to know how gender can contribute to development. And among the genders, we also need to look at women who are considered vulnerable and how we can be able to empower women. Because women are pivotal towards the development of society. Women are pivotal towards societal progress, towards peace, political, economy, etc. We need to look at how women are the essential key towards success. And if that is so, we must have to ensure that gender equity prevails in society. However, we are going to look at briefly some of the forms of gender. When you talk about gender, as I stated earlier, there has been a misconception. We are not only talking about males and females here. However, there have been different some forms of gender categorized by various scholars, which we are briefly going to discuss as we progress. Among these, we have few that we are going to discuss. One of them is homosexual. Now, for social workers, we have always spoken about LGBTQ. And we have always said that we have to protect this gender, and very important, because they are also important in society. We do not discriminate them because of our religious values, because of our cultural values. No, we say they are important, they are relevant, and they are part of us, they are part of our existence. If that is true, we must ensure that we fight for their rights, we must ensure that we maintain their rights, we must ensure that we advocate for them to have a better stay in society. Therefore, we must understand LGBTQ is not the only category of gender. There are other genders that I will be exposing to you today. One of them is homosexual. Among the homosexual, we say the attraction of to gender, the attraction to a gender of the same sex as their own, commonly used to describe someone who is gender binary, female or male. See that? Attracted to the same binary gender, sometimes referred to as a gay. Most of them, as I stated, they are called gays. Why do we call them gay? Because they are mostly attracted towards to the same gender. A man who is attracted to another man is called a gay. And those individuals fall within the category of homosexual. The opposite of this is a lesbian. When we talk about lesbian, what comes in your mind? We say women who are attracted only to other women. See that? When women who are attracted to only other women are called lesbians. And those are also other categories of the gender that we need to understand. You know, and they are important. They are choosing their own path. They are choosing their own life. We must respect them for that. We must not discriminate them. We must always accept them as part of our existence in society. Another category of gender is called bisexual. What bisexual? When you are attracted to two or more genders, this term is generally used to describe being attracted to men and women, but can apply to being attracted to any two or more genders. What am I saying here? These bisexuals are individuals, for example, have people who can be sexually attracted to men and at the same time to their colleagues, females. Or men who can be attracted to their fellow men and at the same time to, when they are bisexual, that means you don't have an alternative. You can fall or be attracted to any of these genders that we have. When that happens, you fall within the category of binary and bisexual. We have pansexual. What is pansexual? We say pansexual when you are attracted to all genders and or do not concern with gender when you are attracted to all someone. Pansexual, these are individuals who they can be attracted to any of the individuals. They can be attracted to people who are lesbian, people who are homosexual, people who are men, people. Anyhow, they can be attracted to them. They are not concerned about those, about the category of gender, but they are just attracted to any other individual so far. Another category of gender can be monosexual. Of course, monosexual is really, this is very unfamiliar. When we talk about monosexual, mono means one, and this simply means individual who are attracted to only one gender. For example, a man who is attracted to only one woman is called a monosexual. A woman who is attracted to only one gender, like a man, that automatically is monosexual. So we also have allosexual. What is allosexual? We say allosexual when you are attracted, when you are not asexual or attracted to at least any gender. They are individuals who mostly they suffer from sexual disorders. They are not attracted to any gender. They are not attracted to men, they are not attracted to women, they are not attracted to anything. These are people whom we refer to as allosexual because they are not attracted to any of these categories of gender we mentioned. But however, psychologists have actually said that there is something wrong with us because somebody needs to be attracted, somebody needs to get sexual satisfaction. Failure to be attracted to an opposite sex, failure to be attracted to any of the gender is a sexual dysfunction, is a sexual disorder. And that sexual disorder can either be as a result of sexual arousal disorder, or it can be as a result of an orgasmic or any other kind of category of sexual disorders that it falls under. But we are going to discuss sexual dysfunction, sexual disorders as we progress in our studies. However, another category is called androsexual. When talking about androsexual, what comes in our mind? Be attracted to masculine gender presentation. There are people who just admire a man because of the way he dresses and then fall in love with that person, especially ladies. When you are a lady and you admire a man for the manner of presentation, for the way he dresses, and fall in love with that man, definitely you fall under the category of an androsexual. While also, if you are a man also, because you admire the way another man dresses, despite the fact that you are of the same sex, you fall for that man and you are attracted to that man because of the dress code, definitely, then you are also under the category of an androsexual. Another category is gynosexual, which is the opposite of androsexual. Gynosexual is a woman, is somebody who is attracted to female gender presentation. For example, there are certain men who just see a woman because the woman passes, and just because of the dress code, they tend to fall within the romantic anointing of that woman, and they are attracted to that individual. And if you are a man, you are that kind of person, you are being attracted based on dress code or whatever presentation, then definitely you fall within the category of gynosexual. And a woman also may decide to fall for the same sex pattern, for the same female pattern, when she sees her colleagues dressing and then decide to admire that individual, definitely individual can automatically. So you begin to see how it works. However, now we progress, ladies and gentlemen. Having highlighted some of the few, of course you already know about the LGBTQ, I have just added a few of these to add them there. Now we progress to the factors affecting the growth of women in our country or in society. When you look at our society, women who are considered one of the major agendas in the world automatically are vulnerable, just as the lesbian, just as the homosexual, just as the other genders. Definitely, women are considered also vulnerable, and they have been subjected for far too long, as postulated by radical feminist sociologists, Foucault, by social workers, and several humanitarian interventions. Automatically, women have been subjected to a lot of problems, women have been subjected to a lot of issues, and therefore, we need to actually attack now. So we are going to look at, briefly, some of the challenges, some of the factors that have been responsible, that have been holding women down, that have been responsible for women's backwardness and lack of growth in society. One, discrimination. Of course, prior to this time, for far too long, women have always been discriminated. Women have always been seen as individuals who are incompetent and are not given opportunities to showcase their talent. They are not being given what they're supposed to actually do. They have been discriminated politically, socially, economically, and all other aspects. Women have always been discriminated. In most examinations, they always ask you to discuss some of the challenges faced by women. And among those challenges, we have discrimination. Discrimination in the political sector. They are not given position. They are not allowed to participate in politics. So in fact, during the 19th century, most places, in most countries, women were not allowed to vote and to be voted for. Women were not allowed to go for certain positions in offices. Women were always allowed. A lot of these discriminations have always been perpetrated. And a lot of these things, so discrimination occurs not only in political houses, not only in social sector, not only in cultural setting, but even in religious houses. You know, we see that for far too long, our religious backgrounds have always set the pace for men to lead, which is why in the mosque, it is the men that are always on top of situation. The women are always there to listen and to obey what the men says. Even in the Old Testament, during the days of Corinth, women were always there subjected to a lot of problems. For example, if you go back to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33 to 36, it actually highlighted during the days of Corinth how women we are not supposed to talk in church, how women we are supposed to be silent in church, and if they have any question to ask, they should go home and ask their husbands, for their husbands should come to church and talk on their behalf. That was an indication of discrimination. That was a justification of this crime. But then we see that discrimination was indeed a challenge faced by women in society. Another challenge that we faced was male chauvinism. This is still evident in our society because male domination is evident. Wherein we see men as people who are powerful in their position, as people who are fit to occupy position, as people who are supposed to lead. And in fact, to the extent that women are not considered when you go to typical male chauvinistic societies like Sierra Leone. Another problem women face that is impeding, that is contributing to their backwardness, is that of an inferiority complex. Even women themselves see themselves inferior. They see themselves as incompetent. Most of them, because of illiteracy, they do not feel that they are competent enough to lead. They always, you know, criticize themselves. They always feel that inferiority complex in them, and that they see their husband as individuals who are competent, as individuals who can stand on front, as individuals who can showcase their talent, however. So we've always actually demonstrated that. But there are solutions to these problems as we progress. If we want women to continue to progress, if we want women to continue to succeed politically, socially, we need to eradicate this tendency of inferiority complex by educating them, by giving them scholarship, by empowering them, by giving them the resources they need, and we can see women at the top. However, another problem they face is illiteracy, as I mentioned. Most of the reasons why women have been subjected to a lot of other maltreatment, to a lot of other backward status, is as a result of their inability to go to school. Prior to this time, women were considered as individuals who were meant for the kitchen, individuals who were meant to take household jobs, and as a result, we are not given the opportunities to contest like just like men. Another problem was lack of resources. You know, even up to date, women still do not have the resources and they have to depend on men for their survival. And if that is so, they will forever continue to be subjected to men. So a lot of these problems And if we are to look and take a roadmap to contribute towards the development of women, we must see how we can provide better resources. We must see how we can empower women through education. We must see how best we can ensure that we create a political platform, economic platform, a social platform to ensure that women are indeed continue to progress from grass to grace, from zero to zero, from nowhere to somewhere, until they progress to the ladder of apex. Ladies and gentlemen, now we progress to the topic called Cedaw Convention. Prior to the one thing I want you to know that the Cedaw Convention means Convention for the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. Now, why was the Cedaw Convention passed by the United Nations? First, let me give you a background. The Cedaw Convention, of course, that is the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, CEDAW, is an international treaty adopted in 1979 by the United Nations General Assembly. It is described as an international bill of rights for women. It was instituted on the 3rd September 1981 and has been ratified by 189 countries. Over 50 countries that have ratified the convention have done so subject to certain clarification, declarations, reservations, and objections. Of course, as I've always said, the world, United Nations have seen that the world was indeed moving in another direction. And in that direction, women were seen as the most vulnerable. Women suffer the most. Women were marginalized. Women, as a result, the convention for the elimination of all forms of discrimination against women was a convention that was passed to give women rights in society, to protect women's rights, to maintain women's rights, and to defend, to ensure that they have their status in society, which was why it was passed. And 189 countries who accepted to ensure that to sign the international treaty for the passing of this convention. There are provisions in this convention which we are going to discuss briefly. And this provision enshrined in the convention says that all these countries must domesticate this convention by creating laws that can protect, defend, and maintain the rights of women. So today, the passing of the Domestic Violence Act in Sierra Leone was as a result of the domestication to now domesticate the CEDAW Convention. The passing of the Devolution of Estates Act, the Registration of Customary Marriage and Divorce Act, the Child Rights Act, we are all acts that were passed in order to complement and domesticate what we call the CEDAW Convention. Even the resolutions that we have passed, we are going to discuss about them in a subsequent lecture on how they have contributed immensely in protecting, in maintaining, in defending the rights of women and how women's rights they became priority. Ladies and gentlemen, the convention is the only human rights treaty that affirms the reproductive rights of women and targets cultural tradition as influential forces shaping gender roles and family relations. It affirms women's right to acquire, change, or retain their nationality and the nationality of their children. State parties also agree to take appropriate measures against all forms of traffic in women and exploitation of women. See, the convention made it clear that women have right to their nationality and even the nationality of their children. And at the same time, at first, women were trafficked. There were trafficking women, child trafficking, and sexual harassment all over the place. So then the convention put an end all this, which is why countries were forced to domesticate these laws, to ensure that they bring those laws into their legislation, into their country, their constitutions, which we have done as a country in Sierra Leone in 2007. Go and start from my gender laws lectures and you see how it was discussed. However, I will now analyze briefly some of the key provisions in the CEDAW Convention. And taking, because we have from part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, part 5, a lot of these parts that, but I only take few of the articles and their provisions that are relevant to what I'm going to discuss now. Now, in part 1, Article 2 of the CEDAW Convention, Part 1, Article 2, it states that state parties, that means all the countries that are going to domesticate the act, that have agreed to sign it, state parties condemn discrimination against women in all its forms, agree to pursue by all appropriate means and without delay a policy of eliminating discrimination against women and to this end undertake. See that? Now when we talk about violence against women, we do not only say to beat them. We have different types of violence. We have physical violence, we have economic violence, we have psychological violence, we have emotional violence, etc. Physical violence is through hitting, that the intention to cause bodily harm, injuries, etc. Emotional violence, if you stress the person, automatically it can lead to psychological problems. If you, for example, you deprive the person by not feeding her, by depriving her not to go to job, to work, by telling her that, by not giving her money, that is economic violence. So all these violence, state parties have agreed that they are going to ensure that they contain it in their country, that indeed both physical, emotional, psychological, and economic violence will be curtailed and eradicated by all member countries who adopt this convention. Ladies and gentlemen, look at the provisions that you are enshrined in Article 2. They have agreed to A, to embody the principle of equality of all men and women in their national constitution or other appropriate legislations, if not yet incorporated. B, to adopt appropriate legislations and other measures, including sanctions where appropriate, prohibiting all forms of discrimination. You see, A is saying that they are going to ensure that they include it in their constitution to eradicate all forms. That means if the constitution has not got any law of such nature, they must include it there. And the second one is also telling us that they will try as hard as possible to eliminate all forms of discrimination that are, and to put measures in place, punishment for all offenders. This was why the Domestic Violence Act was passed in 2007 to see how best an end can be placed on the act of what? Terrorism against women and violence against women. C, to establish legal protection on the rights of women on an equal basis with men and ensure through competent national and other public institutions the effective protection of women against any act of discrimination. D, to refrain from engaging in any act or practice of discrimination against women and to ensure public authorities and institutions. You see, that was why upon the passing of these laws, we have the FSU, the Sierra Police, and various other institutions that were enforcing. Because it was enshrined in the CEDAW Convention that all state parties, for example CEDAW, which was part of the convention, should ensure that they protect this, and they should ensure that indeed women's rights are visible and women's rights are seen. And there should be institutions like the FSU, Family Support Unit, we have the CEDAW Police, and a lot of other institutions created by the government to enforce, uphold, and maintain the practice of this convention that was domesticated in CEDAW. A lot of other things can be seen under Article 2. As you can see. Part 2, Article 7. State parties shall take all appropriate measures to eliminate discrimination against women in the political and public life of a country, and in particular, shall ensure to women on equal terms with men rights. You see that? Now we say that according to Article 7 in Part 2, it states that we are looking at the political and public life. At first, as I stated earlier, women were not given the right to vote and to be voted for. The CEDAW Convention under Part 2, Article 7, gave us the provision for women to participate in political activities just like men, and they should be given equal rights and opportunities, which is why all parties that have signed 189 countries must domesticate that law in Sierra Leone, and that is why it is now enshrined in most of the acts, the gender laws passed in Sierra Leone. However, look at what happens. A, to vote in elections and public referenda, and to be eligible for election to all publicly elected bodies. See that? To participate in the formulation of government policy and implementation thereof, and hold public office and perform all public functions at all levels of government. To participate in non-governmental organizations and associations concerned with the public and political life of a country. See that? This Article 7, Part 2, gave women the right to vote and to be voted for in all the countries that signed this particular convention. And at the same time, they now have the right to participate in, to hold key positions, governmental positions, to go for presidential positions, ministerial positions, parliamentary positions, to become prominent individuals. And not only that, one thing I like, they were not allowed to participate in policy making. You see that Article 7 made it clear that indeed women were now given the opportunity to participate in formulating policy, because it is only when they are part of the policy making process, the laws of the land, that women can be able to input their saying, that women can now have their saying, and women can be, women's voices can now be heard, which was why I believe the Ethelson decided to include it there as part of their criteria. Now let's go to part 4 briefly. Part 4, Article 15. State parties shall accord to women equality with men before the law. See that? That means, it said, two, state parties shall accord to women in civil matters a legal capacity identical to that of men and the same opportunities to exercise that capacity. In particular, they shall give women equal rights to conclude contracts and to administer property and shall treat them equally in all stages of procedure in court and tribunals. Three, state parties agree that all contracts and all other private instruments of any kind with a legal effect that is directed at restricting the legal capacity of women shall be deemed null and void. Four, state parties shall accord to women and men the same rights with regard to law relating to the movement of persons and freedom to choose their residence and domiciles. Now, what am I saying here? In fact, it is on Article 15, Part 4, that made it clear that any law existing in any of these countries that signed the convention, that the law that discriminates against women, the law that stands to prohibit women from participating, that automatically, because the country signed the convention, that law has been declared null and void. See how interesting it is? And of course, also, the men and women are now equal before the law, even in civil matters, because at first, you go to my village, a woman will never win a case there. You know, at all, a woman will never win a case there. Anytime a conflict occurs, they will always ask the woman to beg the man. In fact, as far as they are concerned, men are always right. That male chauvinistic tendency. But you know, this act, I like it so much. The treaty, which is the Cedaw Convention, actually applying the fact that indeed rights should be accorded to women to always be right, even in matter of cases. And a lot of problems also, women should be equal with men at all. There are a lot of other provisions as you go through in the notes. But I want you to know that in summary, the Cedaw Convention, you know, is a convention that helped to protect, maintain and defend the rights of women across the world. And it helped to put women in a strategic position in the roadmap of development, political, social, economy, and worldwide. However, globalization has made women centerpiece of development. Without women, I have a message for you. The fact of the matter is women are very important people. Without women, society cannot develop. I will continue to look at how women's rights are protected and how they are domesticated. In our next lecture, we'll be looking at the Resolution 1320, Resolution 2000, Resolution 1820, and a lot of other laws that help to protect the rights of women in the world. And we're going to look at the differences and the parameters. Once again, thank you for listening, and God bless you. If you have not subscribed, consider doing so. God bless you.